Relay, we're covering today's top boxing news.
Okay, we'll start with this. We now know who it is Lauren Price is going to be fighting early next month in May. She's going to be facing Bavo, Kirsty Bavington.
On the 6th of May, on the undercard of Buatsi versus Stipion.
For what is the British Female Welterweight Championship, the first of its kind, the inaugural title.
Some historical significance.
Historical and intrinsic value. It's important to note that Kirsty Bavington is coming off a points decision loss to Candy Wyatt in her last fight, but she still is a step up from...
She's still a step up from Lauren Price's last opponent, Naomi Manns.
She's still a step up from Naomi because she actually beat Naomi. She beat Naomi Manns before Lauren Price did, so this is still in many ways a better opponent than that opponent, a step up from...
From Naomi.
Lauren Price sports professional record of 3 wins with no losses, no draws, 1 knockout, 1 recorded knockout. She debuted as a professional last year, fought 2 times last year, and she's already fought once this year. The hope is that she will be a more prolific fighter this year than she was last year, that she'll get out there at least 2 to 3 more times.
She's an Olympic gold medalist campaigning in the women's welterweight division, so as you can imagine, for an Olympian, for a medalist, the expectations are high.
This early stage in the game, it's all about getting Lauren Price professional experience, rounds in the bank, and she will, opposite the ring, Kirsty Bavington, who sports a professional record of 7 wins with 3 losses, 2 draws, 2 knockouts, having never been knocked out.
Having never been knocked out in 12 professional contests, 12 to Lauren Price's 3.
Lauren Price, who was last in action in France on the undercard of Tony Yoka versus Carlos Takam, opposite the ring, Naomi Manns.
It was a mostly quiet affair.
Lauren Price just pecking away at Naomi Manns. Naomi, who wasn't that ambitious, wasn't that ballsy.
Thus, the fight wasn't that eventful. When you have someone as fast and athletic and as sharp as Lauren Price, that can intimidate the woman opposite the ring, so much so that they really don't try.
They don't try for a lot of shots. They don't really open up after a while. They're just trying to make it out of the round, trying to survive and trying not to get hit. We used to see this a lot with Clarissa Shields.
The beginning of her career.
I feel like that's what we saw the last time out between Lauren Price and Naomi Manns. Naomi, she just wasn't trying for big shots, trying hard enough.
Hopefully, Kirsty Bavington will make things a little bit more interesting.
Even if you favor Lauren Price to win the fight on points. Even if you do, the goal here is for Lauren to not just bank some rounds, but figure out how to open up these girls, open up these opponents that perhaps aren't trying that hard. Find ways around the guard or through it.
Get punches in there.
Be skilled. You can be as skilled as you want to be, as accomplished as an amateur as you want to be. Your ability to entertain, however, your ability to entertain as a professional.
Yeah,
open
yeah,
up your yeah. opponents and pound on them, pounce on them.
Goes a long way towards a fighter's marketability.
It's not exclusive to female fighters either. I mean, take a look at Guillermo Rigondeaux. That guy was a double gold medalist, but fans often complain that his fights are a bit too quiet.
Uneventful.
In his heyday, he had power and he had counters, but you know, as time progressed, more and more you started hearing that his fights kind of boring.
Which affected his marketability.
Lauren Price is fast enough and athletic enough to be a spiteful combination puncher. She just needs to figure out ways around the guard in order to open up her opponents, open them up for shots.
In turn, as they step her up in class, the hope is that she will be opposite the ring more ambitious opponents, more ambitious fighters than what she's seen so far. And it's okay to give her time because she's only 3-0.
It's far too soon to be judgmental and jump to harsh criticisms. I'm looking forward to seeing how Lauren Price progresses as she climbs up those welterweight rank standings.
You can imagine fighters like Jessica McCaskill and the winner of Sandy Ryan versus Marie-Pierre Huell will be persons of interest to Lauren Price as she inches closer towards a world title.
Cross that bridge when we get to it. For now, she's set to return to action early next month opposite the ring, Kirsty Bavington, and we'll talk more about the fight as the fight date approaches. Men's heavyweight news has previously reported Bob Arum names Andy Ruiz or Joe Joyce as potential opponents for Tyson Fury this summer.
You have to think about the kind of resume that Joe Joyce has and how there are already 2 guys ahead of him in the queue for Oleksandr Usyk, even though they ain't got the kind of resumes that he's got.
Some would say he deserves the fight with Usyk more than they do. Now that negotiations have ceased between teams for Fury and teams for Usyk, Bob Arum, whose company co-promotes Fury, has informed Boxing Scene that the former heavyweight champion Andy Ruiz Jr. is a possible foe for Fury's return to the ring. England's Fury is expected to defend his WBC belt sometime this summer, probably in London.
Joe Joyce would be a possibility, assuming he gets by the Chinese fighter, because Tyson wants to fight this summer, and Andy Ruiz would be a possibility. We're gonna be talking to Tyson next week.
I mean, assuming Joe Joyce wins tomorrow, makes it past Zilei Zhang and does it in good fashion, and barring illness or injury, shouldn't Joe at least be ahead of the queue?
He's on the same side of the street as Tyson Fury.
But all we keep hearing about is Andy Ruiz. Ruiz, who is still affiliated with Al Heyman's Premier Boxing Champions, but Aram doesn't consider that an obstacle that would prevent Fury from fighting Ruiz next.
If that was a fight we were gonna make, I don't think Al would stand in the way, because we would be offering Ruiz a big opportunity for a nice payday.
It doesn't look like Wilder versus Ruiz is going to happen. Talks have gone quiet in reference to that fight that the WBC ordered many weeks ago. Many weeks later,
still nothing.
You have to figure that the only reason Al Heyman might prevent Andy Ruiz from going over the Top Rank and taking on Tyson Fury is because he has something else in mind for him.
So if the Wilder fight isn't happening,
there ain't no other big fights that Al Heyman can make for him. That's the only one.
We had Andy. His purse demands were such that we let him go, and he showed us his ability to earn big money. He's a lovely guy. I mean, I always liked Andy. His father's a nice guy, so I wish him well.
Joseph Parker defeated Andy Ruiz by majority decision in December of 2016 when Ruiz first fought for a heavyweight title while he was being promoted by Top Rank. They both were around that time. A then undefeated Parker won the vacant WBO championship when he edged Ruiz at Spark Arena in Auckland, New Zealand, Parker's home country.
He can fight. We always knew that. He's one of Bruce Trampler's favorite fighters.
That's what Tyson Fury's promoter here stateside has to say about it. In the UK, George Warren, the son of Frank Warren, over there at Queensbury Promotions, he says, "We've not heard from Team Joshua regarding a fight."
The last we heard from Anthony Joshua is that he's not coming back till December.
Rumors abound. Rumors by way of Simon Jordan. Rumors and speculations by way of Tony Bellew. Some figure that a fight between Anthony Joshua and Tyson Fury might happen this year, but it doesn't look to be happening over the summer months. Not at least according to George Warren, who says they ain't heard nothing from Anthony. I don't know the answer to that. The other side spoke a lot about wanting to reach out and contact us after the fight with Franklin. We've not heard anything, not had any contact, so there's been nothing to discuss with Tyson, Warren told Sky Sports. They made it quite clear pre-Franklin fight that they wanted to maybe look at that fight for the summer. They thought maybe there was an opportunity. I haven't heard from them. I haven't had a phone call. I haven't spoken to anyone about it. You'd have to ask them.
There's a lot of rumors right now in the heavyweight division.
But this is what the actual involved parties. Joe Joyce, is looking to put on a good performance, a devastating performance like he did against Parker, and keep building on that momentum. If Joyce comes through a tough fight with a big performance, he puts himself in that conversation to fight Fury, Warren said.
Well, let's see if he does, because Joe Joyce himself seems to want that Fury fight.
He says, "Me and Tyson Fury would be a great British summer fight. Everyone wants to see it."
If he goes in there tomorrow and he does to Zilei Zhang what he did to Joseph Parker in his last fight, I'd have to agree that Fury versus Joyce is a much hotter ticket than Fury versus Ruiz.
I'm hoping for that fight, Joyce told BoxingScene.com. "Me and Tyson Fury would be a great British summer fight. That's why I'm fighting a southpaw now, because I'm getting prepared for one of these title fights, Usyk or Tyson Fury. I'm ready. With Fury, it's a massive fight. Everyone wants to see it. It's a great fight in the making."
The other day, Joe Joyce was talking about how Daniel Dubois, who he already beat, Daniel Dubois is actually ahead of him in the queue for Oleksandr Usyk.
By way of the WBA, he is. Behind him is Croatia's own Filip Hrgović. Filip, who many would argue, actually lost to Zilei Zhang, but he got the nod. He got a decision that he didn't deserve. You think about that. You think about how Joe Joyce was talking about that just the other day. And then you think about all this Andy Ruiz talk.
That they may try to put Andy Ruiz in there with Tyson Fury.
this summer.
You just get the sense that that opportunity really should go to Joe Joyce before it goes to Andy Ruiz, before it goes to anyone else. That if you can't get Joe Joyce the Usyk fight right here and right now, what about a Fury fight? They're on the same side of the street.
In theory, it should be easy to make.
You gotta make it past Zile Zhang first. It's a very tricky, tricky fight, but no risks, no reward. Joyce said of facing Zile Zhang. I'm at the top of the sport right now, and you know, all I need is to cement that title. I think a victory with Zile Zhang is just progressing my journey further.
Joe Joyce is rolling the dice with Zile Zhang because he doesn't have to fight that guy. He's already WBO interim champion. He's already one of Usyk's mandatory challengers. He could sit on that position if he wanted to, but he chooses not to.
Credit to him. Boxing needs more guys like Joe Joyce. It's really good, man, said Joyce, because I don't get that recognition from a lot of people, and Fury, like, he gives me that. So yeah, respect. And you know, I've shared some good rounds with him in sparring, but yeah, that's actually the fight I want. I'm gonna have to get past Zile Zhang first, and you know, hopefully we can make that fight. I've got a lot of respect for the Fury family, but that's the fight I want.
Will Frank Warren and George Warren, will Queensbury deliver Joe Joyce that fight? Because I reiterate, those two guys are on the same side of the street.
Barring unforeseen circumstances, illness or injury, if Joe Joyce makes it through tomorrow's fight in good fashion, doesn't that make him the ideal candidate for a summer blockbuster boxing match?
All British.
Wouldn't you guys say that in the United Kingdom, Fury versus Joyce is a hotter ticket than Fury versus Ruiz?
So Joyce wants that fight.
Where he is right now, he may have to wait some months, maybe even as far as a year, before he gets a crack at Alexander Usyk, because first Usyk's gotta face Daniel Dubois, then maybe they'll see about picking up where they left off with Fury. If they don't, he'll have Filip Hrgović in the queue.
Usyk will have that guy to answer to. How many months will it be? How long is it going to take before Joe Joyce gets to fight for a title?
I don't really think there's any substitute for what was supposed to be Fury versus Usyk, this division's undisputed title fight. I don't really think there's any substitute for that, but if I had to choose between Fury versus Ruiz and Fury versus Joyce, I'd go with Joyce.
It's a better fight.
Men's lightweight and super lightweight news. Ahead of the Ryan Garcia fight, Gervonta Davis has confirmed that Devin Haney, Vasyl Lomachenko, and Shakur Stevenson are on his hit list for future fights. Just how far into the future is the question. I've got some people I want to get. It'd be different fighting them to fighting Ryan Garcia. It'd be more like, I'm coming to get him.
If you've been paying attention over the years, it's quite customary for either Gervonta or his handlers to start making empty promises at or around the time of his fights. They want there to be something beyond what you're about to get, something beyond what you're about to see, though, as stated, they're empty promises.
This has been going on for years. They did this for years with the name of Vasyl Lomachenko. Bear in mind that people have been waiting for Gervonta Davis to fight Vasyl Lomachenko as far back as 2017. We're in 2023 now.
Now he's saying he's looking at Devin. Devin is looking back.
Ahead of his upcoming fight with Vasyl Lomachenko, Devin Haney says, I'll fight Tank at 135, but no rehydration clause. Nobody at 140 intrigues me.
He says this now, but we'll see what he's saying if Teofimo Lopez beats Josh Taylor.
That is at least one fight that's worth some money up there at 140 pounds, depending on the outcome of Taylor versus Lopez. Yeah, we've got to see if this is my last fight at 135. I don't know. There are so many big fights at 135, it's hard for me to go to 140. I can't say that anything at 140 intrigues me, really. All of the big fights are at 135. We have to see how I feel on May 20th, Haney said in an interview with BoxingScene.com and other promoters.
Reporters.
Yeah, of course I would like to stay at 135 pounds to fight Davis. I would love to stay at 135 to fight the biggest names. It all starts on May 20th. I have to beat Victorious in my next fight, and those fights will line up.
You see that Gervonta's talking about Devin. You see Devin's talking about Gervonta. Myself, I'm not holding my breath.
It's a wonder they even got Ryan Garcia to agree to what he agreed to. A catchweight, a rehydration clause, a one-way rematch clause. These other kids ain't gonna go for that.
They're not.
Devin Haney made it evident that he would not agree to catchweight contract clauses as Garcia did with Davis, catering to demands to fight at 136, just a 10-pound rehydration limit. Truthfully, I wouldn't and I couldn't do a rematch clause. At the end of the day, I am a man with the belts and the hardware, said Haney.
Yeah, but we know how Leonard Ellerbe and Gervonta Davis, we know how they feel about Devin Haney and his hardware. They place no value on those belts, no value on legacy and history.
The story's supposed to be that beyond this fight, this upcoming Vasyl Lomachenko fight, Devin Haney will be free to go wherever he wants. wants to go. He will be free of Top Rank. He could end up going to Matchroom.
Going back.
Or he could end up staying there, staying put. Staying on the Top Rank side of things, should they offer him something for a Shakur-Stevenson fight?
In truth, I don't think Devin is as excited about fighting Shakur as he is about fighting either Gervonta or Ryan, the winner of their fight.
If Ryan was to win, we can possibly get it on at 140. Obviously, the world knows I have trouble making 135. Maybe we can do it at 140. Or even 135. No rehydration clause. I never do rehydration clauses. The biggest fights are in the 135-pound division.
Yeah, but how much longer can he keep making it?
You know, the problem with this mindset, this mentality, is that it's centered around never taking a step backwards in terms of the money. When he says the biggest fights are at 135, he's talking about the money. He's talking about the money fights.
Not that I think Gervonta Davis is going to offer him a lot of money.
If he even offers him anything at all, we'll see. That's a story that only time can tell. But so far, no offer has gone from Team Davis to Team Haney. Better still, Team Haney's mindset.
There's big fights to make at lightweight, big fights to make at 135 pounds, and they don't want to go backwards in terms of the money. But that's a problem.
The reason that's a problem is because Devin Haney's a growing boy. His body is still growing. He can't keep making 135 healthy. He can't keep making that weight forever. And at some point, if he's not careful, his body will betray him.
That's right.
You keep boiling down to 135 on the premise of all the money that you can make at 135.
Instead of getting a jump start at your campaign at 140.
And at some point, he's going to have to, because I reiterate, he can't make 135 forever. He's already busting at the seams.
This is all about not taking a step back in terms of the money. That if the big money fights are at 135, then why would you want to go to 140? You want to go to 140 because you can't make 135 forever.
You want to have to find that out the hard way. You go up there, you fight yourself a couple of ham and egg guys while you get used to fighting 140-pound fighters. That's what you should do.
The problem is you don't get paid for fighting those ham and egg guys what you might have been getting paid at lightweight.
Don't want to take a step backwards in terms of the money, but fiscally.
No, they can't all be big fights. They can't all be big paydays.
They can't. And what you're talking about is sacrificing your health and well-being for the bag as opposed to sacrificing the bag for your health and well-being.
At least temporarily, while you'd be acclimating to a new weight, because at some point you're going to have to.
We'll see how he plays it beyond the Vasil-Lomachenko fight if he wins.
If he loses?
I think he'll move up. If he loses to Vasil-Lomachenko, I think he'll go to 140.
Let's see if he does.